This is just brief outline of the today's presentation. I will go through these parts. Hallucinogens, they are also called psychedelic drugs. They are basically classical hallucinogens, dissociatives, and designer drugs. I'm just talking about classical hallucinogens and dissociatives today. Coming to introduction, hallucinogen drugs, they are primarily produce disturbances of perception or thought or mood at low doses and minimal effects on the memory and orientation. Hallucinations can be either any sensory modality, either visual or auditory. Subjects are aware that the experience is caused by the substance and are able to maintain the sense of reality. And there are synonyms for hallucinogens, psychedelics, and psychotomimetics. They are naturally available and they are also synthetic. Coming to classification of the psychedelics, they are classified according to their chemical structure. First, they are indolamines. They are similar to serotonins. These drugs are similar to some of our neurotransmitters. Indolamines are similar to serotonins. In this, LSD derivatives, lysergic acid amines and lysergic acid diethyl amides, and substituted tryptamines. In this, psilocybin, psilocin, diethyl tryptamine, and ibogaine, and ayahuasca. Among these, LSD, psilocybin, ibogaine, and ayahuasca. These are medically useful, and there are recent research about these drugs. And phenylethylamines, they are similar to catecholamines. In this, methoxyamphetamines, they are hallucinogenic amphetamines. In this, mescaline will come. And methylene dioxyamphetamines, they are enantiogenic amphetamines. In this, MDMA will come. And coming to dissociatives, they are similar to phencyclidines. In this, phencyclidine, ketamine, and methoxyketamine, and some other drugs are also there. Coming to miscellaneous drugs, there are some opioid derivatives, dextromethorphan, usually in cough syrups, this compound will be present, and anticholinergics like atropine and trihexyphenidyl, then salvinorin. This is a very new thing that is available as a natural source from some plants in Mexico. They are using for religious purpose and some addiction purpose also. And coming to cannabinoids, this is well known. From coming to modern synthetic drug era, it was begun in 1930s. They started synthesizing these drugs. First of all, incidentally, LSD was synthesized by a Swiss chemist, Albert Hofmann, while working for producing some ergot derivatives to stop the postpartum bleeding. After Second World War, there was an explosion in interest in hallucinogenic drugs in psychiatry because most of the people were presented with psychosis. To do the therapy for the psychosis patients, there was an explosion in increased use of these drugs. These drugs marketed in the market for doing psychotherapy in 1950s. But because of addiction potential, there was a ban in 1967. Coming to different patterns of consumption, LSD, it is available in natural and synthetic derivatives. Natural derivative from morning glory seeds. There is one plant, from that plant it is available. And from one fungus, claviceps purpura, it is available. And coming to synthetic derivatives, synthetic derivatives are crystalline, white, odorless, tasteless powder. It can be dissolved or sublingually, or it can be administered intramuscularly or intravenously. Usually sublingual forms available as postage stamps, chewing gums, and sugar cubes. And other hallucinogens like orally taken hallucinogens are mescaline, psilocybin, and ayahuasca. And smoked forms like dimethyltryptamine and salvia. And snorted dimethyltryptamine can be taken as snorted. Because of psychedelics have some legal issues in procuring the drugs, there is a limited scientific research into the therapeutic potential of these compounds. There are some human evidences of effectiveness of these preparations used by indigenous cultures. In Amazon, there is a report about ayahuasca, and from the Africa, there is a report about ibogaine, and from worldwide, the psilocybin and LSD and ketamine. And there was a saying by Bill Wilson. He was the founder of Alcoholic Anonymous. For his alcohol dependence in problem, he used LSD. He felt that there was no harmful effect with LSD. Instead of, he got benefit out of that. And the mechanism of action of these psychedelic drugs in novel therapeutic use, mainly three mechanisms proposed, like antidepressant effects, neuroplasticity in the brain, and experiential changes. A person experiences some effect, and after that he used to stop the medicines. Like intensity of the subjective effects correlate with the reduction in substance use, and some mystical experiences have been described as experience of reality surpassing the normal human understanding. After that experience, people used to stop using drugs. Coming to LSD, LSD is most commonly studied, and there are a lot of literature. Coming to psychic experiences elicited by the phenylethylamines and the indole ketamines, there was a cross tolerance between the two classes of these drugs, and after that they came to know that there is a shared mechanism of action among all the psychedelic drugs. LSD is extremely potent substance. It is active doses about 0.5 to 2 mg per kg. And predominantly, it acts on the serotonin receptors, the two 5-H2 receptors, and some also some effect on 5-HT1A and 1C receptors. It will act both presynaptically and postsynaptically. It is well absorbed through GIT, usually oral route they prefer, and rapidly metabolized. Only 1% of the unmetabolized form is excreted through the urine. After 24 hours of consumption also, this can be detected through urine drug test. And psychoactive effects peak at around 2 to 4 hours and can last for about 12 hours. It depends upon the dose and tolerance and body weight of the patient. And usually autonomic symptoms, they will start within few minutes. After that, psychoactive effects approximately 10 to 15 minutes after that, they will start. And autonomic symptoms, mainly sympathomimetic effects, usually elevated blood pressure, pulse, diaphoresis, pyloerection. Some patients may present with anisocoria, unequal pupils, and hippus, rhythmically dilating pupils. Usually sensory effects appear within 1 hour after administration. At a higher doses, there is another effect by name synesthesia. People may perceive sensations in different modalities, such as hearing the colors. At higher doses, this will happen. Some people may experience good trips and bad trips and psychic numbness after prolonged use of LSD. A good trip is basically an overall experience is perceived as enlightening. And bad trips like anxiety, panic attacks, they will experience. And psychic numbness is the psychic experience generally lasts for about 8 to 12 hours. And after that, patient feels a pleasant experience. This is called psychic numbness. And tolerance is usually developed for psychological effects. There is no tolerance for physical effects. That's why physical dependence and withdrawal symptoms are very rare with LSD. And if patient is intoxicated, they can have symptoms of sympathetic activation and perceptual changes and some psychiatric symptoms like anxiety and psychotic symptoms. And then some people, they experience hallucinogen persisting perception disorder. Usually they experience the flashbacks of the psychic phenomenon when patient taken the LSD. They experience when patient is out not taking LSD also. And some patients, they develop persistent psychosis related to mental illnesses like visual hallucinations, grandiosity, and over-religiosity. And coming to LSD use in addiction management, in 1950s and 60s, there was a substantial research on LSD being used as a treatment for alcohol dependence. But in recent years, after that ban in US, it was stopped. And but in recent years, once again, it was reignited because of antidepressant effect in healthy. There was a study by McLean et al. In 2011. In healthy humans, individuals have reported long-term increase in optimism following LSD. And some people also experience the same thing after psilocybin administration. And because of some mechanism about neuroplasticity, a single dose administration of LSD in rats induces gene transcriptions in prefrontal cortex associated with increased plasticity. This was done by Nicholas and et al. In 2002. And there was one meta-analysis by Krebs and et al. In 2012. They reviewed about six randomized control trials to assess the efficacy of LSD in the treatment of alcoholism. They studied around 536 participants in total. Across the studies, they found that 59% of the active treatment participants versus 38% of the control showed a reliable improvement during the first follow-up for about 1 to 2 months. And these differences was reliable up to 6 months after follow-up also. And there is one study by Savage and et al. In 1973. They found about opioids. The LSD is used in opioid dependence syndrome also. They demonstrated some degree of effectiveness. Coming to mescaline, this is 3,4-5-trimethoxyphenylethylamine, and this is a hallucinogen. There are some natural sources. It is usually present in peyote. Peyote is a plant name, and San Pedro. This is first isolated from peyote cacti. Usually it is consumed in cultural events and this is a hallucinogenic dose of approximately 5 mg per kg. And these cacti buttons contains approximately 50 to 100 mg of mescaline. Usually, one person consumes 3 to 8 buttons. And there was no any studies related to mescaline in addiction management or any psychiatric disorders. And coming to tryptamines, there are some controlled tryptamines and non-controlled tryptamines. Coming to controlled tryptamines, psilocybin is the main compound. It is present in psilocybin mushrooms. They are also called magic mushrooms. And mushrooms can be eaten fresh or dried or brewed. Psilocybin is a pro-drug. And after consumption, it is converted into psilocin. That is a pharmacologically active compound in human bodies. A typical dose of psilocybin range from 4 to 20 mg. That is correspond to 1 to 2 grams of dried mushrooms. Usually sympathomimetic symptoms occur at lower doses, and psychological effects are elicited by doses about 8 mg. And psychological effects begin within 30 minutes of ingestion and peak at around 2 to 3 hours, and they disappear by 12 hours. Coming to psilocybin use in addiction management, It can be used in nicotine addiction problem and alcohol dependence problems. They found that there is some mystical experiences were associated with psilocybin after that person stops smoking nicotine. And with alcohol dependence, there was a intensity of subjective effects and mystical experiences after that patient reduced intake of alcohol. And there was a open label trial with psilocybin has found a preliminary evidence of efficacy following a single dose in the treatment of treatment-resistant depression patients. And psychedelic drugs may also switch off or disrupt the brain circuits involved in the ruminative style of thinking and anhedonia feelings in depression. And coming to nicotine dependence smokers, there was a study by Johnson and et al. In 2014. They found that 15 nicotine dependent smokers were given psilocybin in moderate and high doses of psilocybin with within a structured program of cognitive behavioral therapy. Means some patients given psilocybin and some patients given cognitive behavioral therapy. At 6 months follow-up, 12 of the 15 patients, they were smoking free. And at around 12 months of follow-up, 10 participants were smoking abstinence. And after long-term follow-up, around 16 months, 9 participants were they still smoking abstinent. And similarly, by Bogenschulz et al. In 2015, they studied in alcohol use disorders. 10 volunteers with severe alcohol use disorders were given psilocybin alongside a psychosocial intervention. A significant reduction in drinking was observed relative to pre-psilocybin levels. And although there are promising that these studies suffer from some absence of control group, they didn't include any control group. And more rigorous studies are they are underway. And dextromethorphan, this is the dextroisomer of levonorgestrel. Usually cough syrups contain this compound. Usually it is given as 15 to 30 mg orally. And there are no studies or research about the use of dextromethorphan in addiction management. And coming to salvinorin A, this is a psychoactive substance in the plant salvia divinorum. Usually this plant is available cultivated in Mexico. This compound is most potent and naturally occurring hallucinogen. They used to facilitate the visionary states of consciousness during spiritual healing sessions. And there are some differing studies suggest no overall consensus so far with regard to the long-term effects of salvia and more. But after some chronic use of this plant product, there was a depression-like states occurred in some people, some researchers noted. Coming to ayahuasca, this is commonly called yage, and this is a hallucinogenic brew of various psychoactive infusions and decoctions prepared from different plants. Like they prepare decoctions from Banisteriopsis capi vine, and they used to mix with some leaves of genus Psychotria. These leaves contains a DMT product. This DMT product usually inhibit the degradation of this ayahuasca in the GIT, and this will go into the circulation and it will give the psychoactive effect. And ayahuasca in addiction management, it's usually psychedelic effects like visual and hallucinatory stimulation, the mixing of sensory modalities and psychological introspection that may lead to greater elation and fear and illumination. There is one recent observational study about ayahuasca. It's used in alcohol, cocaine, and tobacco addiction disorders. There are improvements in subjective well-being in a sample of 12 people who were treated with ayahuasca for these drug problems. And ibogaine is an indole alkaloid. It's present in Tabernethe iboga plant. And the plant is, this plant is cultivated in Africa. Usually hallucinations occur after 400 mg of ibogaine. Some tryptamines that act as agonists and antagonists and at receptors 5-HT2A and NMDA receptors, it will act. And it is metabolized in the human body by cytochrome P4 to 450-2D6. And major metabolites are nor-ibogaine. Ibogaine has to be given to the patients in high doses. And there are established toxic effects of ibogaine also. That's why ibogaine is stopped using in research purpose and addiction management. There are some few studies about ibogaine. It will basically act as a neuroplastic agent. And it will give some experiential changes with this mechanism of action. It will work in addiction management. Over the past 3 decades, ibogaine has received interest as a possible anti-craving and anti-withdrawal aid for the drug addiction, primarily for opioid and cocaine addictions. But because of harmful effects, the ibogaine was stopped using in addiction management. And there was no RCTs and double-blind studies regarding ibogaine. And more recently, there was interest reignited with two new observational studies that is going, currently they are going on in Mexico and New Zealand. These results and ongoing studies are very promising about addiction management, but properly controlled and experimental research is much needed because of harmful effects from the ibogaine. There are some case reports and case series are available regarding ibogaine effect in addiction management. Coming to dissociative substances, fencyclid and ketamine. Ketamine is mostly used substance in mental health and addiction management. Because of adverse effects of fencyclidine, it was discarded from being used because it produced delirium and hallucinations after surgeries. Ketamine is available as S and R isomers. S isomer is most potent, and intramuscular intravenous route is used as an analgesic and anesthetic purpose. And other administrations like orally, or smoking, and by inhalation, people used to dependent on ketamine, and these routes are useful for addiction management also. And the elimination half-life of ketamine is 2 to 3 hours. Effects are very fast. At low doses, it works as a mild dissociative effects, and then there is a distortion of time and space, and it can produce hallucinations. And but at large doses, there is a severe dissociation with intense detachment, such that their perceptions seem to be located deep within their consciousness. And intoxication, it will produce tachycardia, altered consciousness, and disorganized speech and nystagmus. And usually for intoxication, symptomatic treatment is advised. It is a good safety about ketamine because it is a minimal impact on the respiratory system, and there is a short half-life, and the psychedelic effects, they wear off very quickly after infusion. And the mechanism behind using for addiction management is there is an experience of experiential changes there is some mystic experience. After that, people used to stop using other drugs. And ketamine is also a very commonly used substance for treatment resistant depression. And ketamine is used to produce neuroplasticity. This is the main mechanism behind using for the addiction management and mental illnesses. Usually it is a NMDA receptor antagonist. It may seem to produce a paradoxical that it produces neuroplasticity. And recent work in animals shows that ketamine mediated a blockade of NMDA receptors. It triggers a sequence of intracellular signaling, that is phosphorylation of eukaryotic elongation factor 2, that results in desuppression of brain-derived neurotrophic factor that leads to neuroplasticity changes in CA1 region and dentate gyrus in the brain. These regions are very crucial for learning and memory. And coming to addiction management, ketamine is studied in alcohol dependence by Krupinski et al. In 1997. There was an impressive 66 of detoxified alcoholics were found to maintain abstinence a year after ketamine therapy, as compared to 24% of those patients who engaged with conventional treatments. However, there are no randomized controlled studies at that time. And till now also, there was no any RCT studies about the use of ketamine in addiction management. And there is an impact of ketamine administration on cocaine abuse have also been investigated. But ketamine administration combined with relaxation has been shown to increase the motivation to quit the cocaine drug. And take home messages: in the next 5 years, there will be a clearer evidence for use of these compounds. Maybe it will come. And ayahuasca and ibogaine show a promise from lower quality studies, but RCTs are needed, because ibogaine has a very prominent toxic effects that lead to some deaths in some research studies. Abuse potential of all these compounds are particularly when used in therapeutical doses appear to be very low. And this is an exciting time to research into psychedelic drugs. The evidence reviewed suggests a potential place in modern medicine for these compounds.